All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Trinity Sunday. We appreciate you joining us on your laptop, smartphone, I don't know, tablet, whatever it is you have. Very glad that you're here with us, and we want to welcome you on this Trinity Sunday as we gather to not necessarily comprehend. We got to turn our lights on. I forgot. I don't know if it helps. Okay. As we try to not comprehend God's mystery, but to enjoy it, bask in it, and worship and wonder in it, okay? Just a few announcements real quick. If you joined us for our Sunday School session, you heard an amazing, I think a really good session from our guest teacher, David Finnegan Hosey. I have two copies, one of each of his books. They're both signed by the author. I would love to give these away. I'm going to give one away today and one away next week. Here's how we're going to do it. This is how we're going to, the first book, more like a memoir, but then how the church discusses and talks about mental health in their, so there's a lot of theological reflection, there's a lot of practical ministry experience stuff in here. Really well written. He's a fantastic writer. You can earn this book, you can win it. If, here's my challenge, it's homework, it's not, you can't win it today. You're going to have to be able to win it sometime this week. And here's how you do it. Right now, the movie, Just Mercy, based on the book, Just Mercy by Bryan Stevenson, is available to watch free practically on every streaming platform. Or you can go probably rent it somewhere. You can even go buy it somewhere. I highly recommend that. You could probably find a copy if you're not comfortable with streaming through Netflix or Amazon Prime. The first person this week to comment or to message me or text me or call me and let me know that you watched the movie Just Mercy, the first person, you get this. You get a copy of David Finnegan Hosey's book, Christ on the Psych Ward. We'll talk next week about how you can win his second book, which is Grace is a Pre-Existing Condition. I encourage you actually to go purchase these books from his website, davidfinneganhosey.com. I'll make sure to get it posted out there. Because if you buy a copy of his book, the proceeds, I'm pretty sure it's this book. If you buy a copy of this book, the proceeds from it go to RIP medical debt, to excuse medical debt for first responders right now. So fantastic way to both get a great book and to help somebody out who might need it. All right, another announcement, of course, we sent out the bishop's phased plan reopening. It's in four stages to everybody through email this week. Let me know if you didn't get a copy of that. We'll make sure you get that. We are currently in stage one, which is shut down completely until June 15th. And the feeling is she's probably not going to extend that. We'll probably hear that this week. However, it doesn't mean we're opening right back up. If you saw her staged reopening plan, you'll notice there's lots of conditions in every stage before you can even think about having people. And the next stage, stage two, is only for 10 or less people. Stage three is 50 or less. And then stage four is virtually open. But every one of those stages up until stage four includes very strict restrictions on vulnerable people, which is practically our entire congregations in both churches. So leadership, we're going to discuss leadership of both churches. We're going to be discussing how we're going to approach that. But we just want you to be aware, just because stage one is done with the strict restrictions next, not tomorrow, but next month, the Monday after that, June 15th, don't be thinking we're going to open right back up and you can just do, you know, come with us. It's going to be a while, and we have to submit plans to even be, to even be approved to open in whatever stage it is. So, heads up on that. We'll send out a letter with more information about that. Leadership will be discussing our plans and what stage we think we're going to open back up. All right? And a final announcement. Last week, I offered you a challenge, a listening discipleship challenge. Go ahead, Kyle, bring up the slide. We are going to begin our first book on July 1st, 2020. The first book is How to Be an Anti-Racist by Ibram X. Kendi. I know that they're sold out of this book in a lot of places, so you're going to want to back order this. That's why I'm waiting until July 1st to start it up. If you have it, feel free to already begin. It's a really good book. Get it on your Kindle or a reading app if you can't get a physical copy. It's hard to find right now. But there are lots of options, lots of places to find this book and get on a back order list, okay? But that's the first book we're going to be beginning with. And this week I will email out to everybody who's accepted the challenge a calendar for the next year of reading, okay? All right, and that's my final announcement on that. We will begin with some opening words written by Hans Holznagel. For the manyness of God's creative splendor, before Jesus' humility and the power of Christ's commands, for the mystery of relationship, God's with us and ours with one another, come, let us worship the triune God. Our opening song. This time we will be sharing some joys and concerns. Please lift up your joys and concerns in the comments there. I probably won't read them right now, but just let our community here know what we can be praying for. I have a couple that were shared through text messaging and email. I'll share those, and then we'll lift up in prayer. We'll come to prayer together. But please feel free to share in the comments some specific requests you'd like people to be holding up in their hearts as we pray our prayer. So one thing we want to be sure and be in prayer about, Bonnie Hill, her son Peter. Peter hurt his back a while ago and is experiencing some very odd symptoms. Didn't have a primary care doctor at that time, but does now, and they're hoping that an MRI will soon be on the schedule so that they can get some answers. Okay, so be in prayer for Peter there. Also be in prayer for Beth Calkins and her husband, Richard. He had, seems to be so far, a very successful back surgery about a week ago. There was some scariness in the recovery room, but they are home now and he's doing remarkably well. No hurts right now, stands up pretty straight, not taking any pain meds, walking inside with only a cane, so praise God for it going so well, and we pray for continued healing. And the same thing for Tim as well. Tim also had a back surgery and is dealing with some complications from that still, so we'll continue to pray for Tim and Tim's back. We want to lift up, especially right now in the Pacific Northwest, our camping ministry. Like probably many or most camps around the country and camping ministries around the country, there just won't be any summer ministry camps, and that's true in the Pacific Northwest for our camping. So we want to be in prayer for our PNW camps. It'll be a big, obviously a huge financial hit for them. So very important that all the churches in the Pacific Northwest continue to support the camps in our area. All right? So we'll be prayer for that, prayer for the staff, directors, and in the camping board of ministries too. A camping ministry board, yeah. We also want to be in prayer for Earl Loomis. Sorry, slipping there. Earl's in the ICU at Sacred Heart Hospital in Spokane with heart and lung issues. So let's pray for Earl and the Earl's wife Mary and the family at that time. Okay, that was sent to us from Georgia Brotnoff, so we appreciate the request. Please, throughout the week, feel free to email or text or call me with any of your concerns. Let the people know who are reaching out to you on their calling tree, and we'll make sure those get in on the prayer list. So please, if you would, please bow your head or take an attitude of prayer. We'll pray right now for concerns, and then we'll join all together in a prayer for Trinity Sunday. God, today we come before you. It's just been a wild, tough, challenging year in so many ways. We continue to struggle through a pandemic. We continue to wrestle with issues concerning racism and different things going on, God, just troubling times. And so, God, we look to you. We pray for your guidance, for courage. Above all, God, we pray that you would fill us with your spirit of love, so that we're told in your word that the perfect love casts out fear, so that we might minister in your name of love and grace. Help us remember that, God, as many of us are not knowing exactly how to respond to everything, what to say. God, you know what? Sometimes we just need to just zip it and pray for your guidance and your will. Pray for me as I continually mess up at trying to be a minister of truth and grace and love. But I pray for all of us as we are walking through sure dark times, but also really opportune times to be ministers of your love and grace and truth, God. We pray for people who are impacted by all this going on, people who are wrestling with implications of protesting and riots and things going on, and people who are now asking questions about systems of injustice and what we can do to tackle those things. I pray for us. I pray for your country, this country, God. I pray for our leadership, that they would have hearts turned toward you and be filled with spirits of your wisdom and love as they make decisions and set policies and hear voices of people who maybe haven't been heard from, truly heard from, for a long time. God, we lift up people we know personally who are wrestling with mental health issues, anxiety right now, and just stress and just the impact all of this has had on our mental health. We just lift up people to you now wrestling with that. God, we are thankful for your love. We're thankful for your presence. We're thankful for people continuing to minister in your name and to serve and to reach out and to hug and to hold and to listen. Just thankful. Thankful that we can clearly see you moving still in all of this, if we have eyes to see. God, I'm thankful. I'm thankful for another week, another chance to serve, to bear witness, to just be here in this valley as a presence. We love you, God, and we ask this in your Son's name. And we join all together with a prayer for Trinity Sunday, saying, we bind unto ourselves today the strong name of the Trinity, by invocation of the same, the three in one and one in three, of whom all nature has creation, eternal Father, Spirit, Word. Praise to the Lord of our salvation. Salvation is of Christ the Lord. Amen. And now we actually have two scripture readings today. So I'll read the first one from Matthew 28. Verses 16 through 20, and then I think we have a song we couldn't quite get done last week. We're going to get it done this week because it's really good. A lot of great creative work went into this, and it's very appropriate for right now. So, but Matthew 28 first, 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always to the end of the age. Thanks be to God. This is the living word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides the silent cries, only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open door. People need the Lord.
People need the Lord.
People need the Lord. When will they realize need the Lord? We are called to take His light to a world where wrong seems right. What could be too great a cause for sharing life with one who's lost? Through His love our hearts can feel all the lift they bear. They must hear the words of life. Only we can share. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize that we must give our lives for peace? The Lord. People need the Lord.
Hello, and welcome to Online Children's Moment. Today we're going to take a little bit of a departure from where we usually sit because I wanted to show you. Sorry if the camera moves. Some of you know I have been in seminary or graduate school for learning about God. And these are a few of the books that I have to help me in my learning. And today we're talking about something that we learned quite a bit about in our first year of seminary, the Trinity. Now, when I say that, you might think that means I know what the Trinity is. No. So I have written papers on the Trinity. I have done a lot of reading. I have books specifically about, let's see, I just found this one. Let's see. The Controversy of the Trinity. And I just lost it too. That's impressive. I have, maybe I need to work on my organization for this whole thing. One book that I did want to show you was this. This is Trinity 101, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, by one of my professors, James Papandrea. He was a really good professor, got us thinking and talking. This whole book is dedicated to the concept of the Trinity. And because it's thin, you might think it's straightforward and simple. Again, no. If I could read a passage or a sentence from page 121. Whatever the name, the point is that in the Trinity, even the distinction between persons is at the service of the unity and is oriented toward the oneness of God. Something to dwell upon. So the reason I'm showing you all this and telling you all this is that there's still a lot of mystery to how we see the Trinity, to how we see lots of aspects of our faith. And so as you're entering, and maybe newer to our church and faith, as children coming into it, there's still a lot to learn, but we all have still a lot to learn. And really, I think the best thing to keep in mind as we go through this different mystery phase is that the unknown isn't bad. The unknown isn't something to be feared or avoided. It's just a natural part of our faith, of our lives, and of the world around us. So just keep that in mind, that in the mystery, there are an unknown. There are ways that God is working that we aren't able to see yet. So keep that in mind. I also would really encourage you to not be discouraged. Because we're not looking for answers sometimes when we're learning about these different things. We're learning how to better ask questions. So keep that in mind as we go forward, and we all are learning together. It really is a great opportunity that we have to ask all these great questions and to struggle with different ideas of what God is and how he comes and is part of our lives, and struggle with how we live out his word in his world today. Just keep that in mind. If anyone would like to borrow some of these books, let me know. I mean, this one's a really good one. Honestly, I read a good portion of this one and I need to read it again because I have lots of questions still. But there are a lot of really good questions out there, a lot of really good sources as we go forward and learn. I look forward to learning with you guys as we go. So why don't we go ahead and take an attitude of prayer, whatever that looks like for you. Dear Lord God, thank you for this time together. Thank you for the mysteries and the unknowns that we face together. And thank you also for the family that we have to face this with together. Thank you for this Communion Sunday, where we come together around another mystery of yours, the table of communion. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
All right. Thank you, Kaylissa. Great children's moment. and I'm going to do our second set of scripture reading. It's very short. It's from 2 Corinthians 13. It's actually how Paul, or the author of Corinthians, ends the letter as a final greeting and benediction. 2 Corinthians 13, 11 through 13. Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. This is the living word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Wonderful song there. If you ever want to join us in our virtual choir, just let us know. We will sort it out for you, figure it out. Mark has it down to a science. What's that? Okay. So Mark has it down to a T, so he can get you up to speed on how you can join in. Just let me know, and I'll make sure you get connected with Mark. It's a beautiful gift that Mark and Chris have been giving us with that virtual choir. I think it's really elevated our worship time together. So thank you. Thank you so much, Mark, for that. And beautiful video, too, that he's been putting together for Prelude Postlude. Fantastic. I want to tell you, one of the greatest gifts that my father gave to me wasn't a physical gift of some kind. I mean, of course, my dad and my mom over the years have given me lots of physical gifts. Different bits of technology, shoes, clothing, toys, all that kind of stuff growing up. But the gift that I treasure the most. I can't really describe so much as just tell you a story that helps kind of get to it. When I had been away at college for a while, was in college at Boise Bible College, almost wrapping up, a couple years in. Well, I guess I wasn't quite close to wrapping up yet. Maybe I was in my second or perhaps third year. But I can remember my dad began calling me and texting me, messaging me, and had serious questions about church, theology, faith, and other things, of course, too, sports and different things like that, football most often. But I can remember the feeling that that gave me, that my dad came to me, my dad, who my whole life had been this, an authority type figure, somebody that I looked up to and trusted, whose wisdom I earnestly sought out most of my life. I wasn't like, sometimes I hear people, they have stories where they had this relationship with their parents in their teen years where they felt like they knew nothing. And so, you know, as you got older, you learned, oh, they did know what they were talking about. I didn't have that. My whole time in high school, that's part of growing up too, but I never once ever did I ever think I knew more than my parents, or I couldn't trust their wisdom, that they didn't know what they were talking about. I always believed that. And so for me, it was an incredible gift for my father to reach out to me in a similar way, because it felt like, you know, like a rite of passage, so to speak, that my father was now trusting me with some wisdom and asking me questions, not necessarily about, you know, giving advice, but just to learn from me. What an incredible gift that was, that my father invited me into that type of relationship where we were, like, in a sense, equals, because we learn from each other. I love that. I love that fantastic exchange and gift that my father gave to me. So today in our scripture reading, our first one, Jesus, it's like he's had several appearances. He'd showed up to his friends post-resurrection several times. This is another occasion. In fact, it will be the last occasion that they see him post-resurrection. And he takes them to a familiar place. He takes them to a mount, a hillside, where he had first spoken to them and appointed them in their role as disciples. I think there's a lot going on there. I think it's a wonderful move by Jesus that he takes them back to a place that they needed to go back to, so that they could kind of like, he's taking them back to the beginning, so to speak, so that they can move forward once again. And I think what's happening there, just as kind of like a sidetrack, you know, sometimes in our life, we need to go back and revisit some things and some moments in our lives, in our individual lives, and experience them again, and perhaps come to those places with a new perspective. And I don't mean just like a physical place. I mean like maybe going back and remembering things like your wedding day, or perhaps graduation, or moments like that, where now with some different perspective, you're going back and you're seeing it again in a different way, but also with all of the elements that you had originally too, still there too. What's happening here with these disciples is, you know, they probably have this sense, we've let Jesus down. Right, we'd been with Jesus for 3 years in discipleship, and when push came to shove, we were not there for Jesus when he was going through his most trying time. And so you can imagine that they bring with them this question, maybe a guilt, maybe a shame, where we didn't live up to Jesus' expectations and we failed. And yet Jesus brings them to this place where they first started, clearly sending a message like, look, it's okay. Look, I still have work for you to do. You're gonna mess up more, but I still have this mission for you. You can do it. Let's go back to the beginning, and it's like I'm recommissioning you again. In fact, that is what he does. He commissions them there. And so that's kind of a little sidetrack about what's happening there, but I want you to notice he takes them back to the beginning to begin again. I am trusting you with my ministry. You can do this. Let's start again. Now, Jesus makes a claim here, post-resurrection, in this new moment where he's commissioning them again. He makes a claim about authority. The word he uses is all. All authority in heaven and on earth is now given to me. And that is a big statement to unpack. And we could talk about that quite a lot, about what does it mean. All authority. Like, huge amount of authority and power. But what I want to focus in is actually the words he uses for authority and power, all power and all authority. He uses an interesting word for power. In the Greek there, as it's written, the most common word for power that people would speak or use or write back then in the first century is the word dunamis. Dunamis. I think it was more like dunamis. That's kind of like where we actually get the word that kind of we associate with power of dynamic, dynamite, dunamis, this incredible power, all right? And it actually literally it has this idea with it of like a self-contained power. I have this power within me, right? This incredible amount of authority and power contained within me. That's not the word he uses. Actually, the word he uses is a less common word for power, which is also in Greek, it's the word exousia. Exousia, all right? Exousia. And that word for power is actually not a self-contained power, like I hold within me all of this power. It's actually a power that comes through passing on. It's like passed on power. And you see now why this fits here in this moment, right? Because he's commissioning them to go out and to do his ministry, what he does. And so this power is the type of power that is passed on. It's meant to flow through and out to other people. And that's the word he uses as he's commissioning them, as he's sending them out. And he tells them, I'm giving you this power and this authority to go. And it shows up right in the practice of baptism that he's giving to them, like he's ordaining here this baptism seal of like passing on the authority. And notice he uses it, he says, to baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we got this Trinity thing going on here, which is fits nicely with this, right? Because within the Trinity, we have this idea of how do you explain it? How do you describe it? How do you define it? But it's like these three interwoven, interconnected relationships where it's like you can't tell where one ends and where one begins, if there is an ending or a beginning of any one of the, you know, and the power that flows, the exousia that flows through them all. Or it all, or again, words, we just cannot quite describe it. And that's the power that Jesus is giving to his disciples that is passed on and down and through until it ends up here with us, of course. That's the power. That's where the real power lies. Not within holding it in, right, which is how we typically approach power dynamics. There it is I've got to grab it and I've got to hold it. I've got to get the power that's mine. I need to grab hold of that authority and hold it to me. And you'll notice a lot of leaders in history and in today are about what can I hold on to? What authority can I claim within myself and hold on to? And in Jesus, we see a totally different type of power. And in our ministry, same thing. We're not to be the dunamis type of power. We rely on the passed on power that flows from that day to this, in us, through us, and on to other people, so that they too have that power, right? In the baptism, in our vows, we talk about this power now that is flowing through us, that we're a part of this stream of power, that we can go and do these things, okay? That's why I talked about my dad earlier, right? And just this sharing of that authority, so to speak. I read that second passage of Scripture in Corinthians. It's very quick, it's very light, but I read it on purpose because Paul's talking about a community that's encouraging, he's encouraging them to live out this power, right, among each other. Among you, please, let there be peace. Not a wrestling or over who can claim the power and authority, but have an agreement with each other. Now, Paul clearly does not mean, because he's said in other places, does not mean that everybody exactly think exactly the same. No, in fact, he says there must be some differences among you, but that you have this agreement with each other, that it's not about me being right and you being wrong, because that's power dynamics in the wrong way. But it's about, like, you know what, maybe I need what you're bringing to this conversation. I might not agree with you, but what together, how can we connect to have this power that flows in and through us rather than me trying to hold on to that power, right? In his benediction and closing of this letter, that's what he's praying for them, that you would have that going on in your midst, peace and love, right? And so that the power and love, he even talks about that the love of God then might be on display for everybody. Because we know, right, from Jesus' example and Jesus' teaching, what it means, what God is like. God isn't a self-containing power, but from creation until now, power that goes and gives and pours out to other people and to other things and to other into creation. That's how we got here, was because God didn't contain the power, but the love flowed from God to give power to everything else. Okay, that's where I'm going to end and land this one today. The wrestling out of those implications, well, that's what it means to be church. How can we as a community allow that power to flow through us and out to other people rather than try to hold on to it and hoard it or protect it or preserve it even, but rather how can we empty it out for others as well? That's my prayer for us as a community. How can we use that power of God's love to let it flow through us out to others? All right, let's pray. And then I think we have, after prayer, we've got, I'll talk about offering a little bit, closing song and all that. All right, so please pray with me. God, I pray that we would be people who are examples of this given power, this power that is given away type of power, that we would be people like Jesus who don't hold on to position and authority and power, but that we actually find the power lies in passing it on to other people. That God, how would that shape every one of our relationships in so many different ways? It'd be incredible. It'd be incredible. And so I pray, God, that we would look for the opportunities to practice that power, to pass on that love, because that's where the power is. God, we love you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, just a few notes about offering. I think you probably have these memorized by now, I'm sure. But just in case, maybe you're new with us and don't know about this, I'm going to show you a few ways you can still give while we're kind of shut down here. So first, of course, you can mail in your tithes and offering checks. There's the addresses there. You can also find our addresses in lots of different ways, on the Facebook pages, on the website, in the phone book, in the newspaper, lots of ways. You can also drop off money. Call first. Please call first, because right now it's very hard and few and far between these times where anyone's in the office, but it is a way if you can connect with somebody. And then, of course, online giving. Clarkson's page, green box or green button there at the top of the page. Click that. It will take you to a place where you can give. Over on the Lewiston page, same type of situation. Go to that Contact Us menu button, drop it down, and you'll find giving. Click that. It'll take you to a page where you can give. In addition to online, you can also download a mobile app, so you can just pull it out and have it with you anywhere you go. You don't have to be at a computer or a laptop or a desktop. For Clarkston, you're going to want to go to either the iTunes store or the Apple store or the Google Play store. Look for the app Tithely, T-I-T-H-E.L-Y, Tithely. Find that app, download it, search for Clarkston UMC, and you can just give right through that. Lots of different options. Same thing for Lewis and First, but a different app. You're going to look for the Give Plus mobile app. Sign up for it, download it, and then look for Lewiston First UMC or United Methodist Church, and you can give through that app there too. All right, that was a quick rundown, but I think you've got it. Or you can text or message me or call me, and we can walk you through it too, different ways you can give. And we sure appreciate your faithful giving during this time. It has helped tremendously, tremendously. So let me pray for our offering today, and then we will do our closing song and benediction. Please pray with me. God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to give. That's one of the ways right there that we don't hold on to the gifts that you've given to us, but that we let it flow through us and from us out to others. And this is one way, God, that we can give to the church and then minister in your name, not holding on to those resources, but using them to empower, give that power to other people too. God, I'm so thankful for the faithful givers who've been doing this from March until now, continuing to give and continue to be faithful. I'm amazed at their generosity and their faithfulness. We thank you, God, for that. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now for our closing song. Thank you. We want to say thank you to Chris and to James and to Sharon and to Mark, who continue to really help us stay connected in worship and singing during this time. They do a fantastic job. Sure appreciate that with the videos and all that. Now, if you would please join me in a benediction. Should be up there on your screen, I believe. Join me. Let's say it all together. May we go forth, not in the strength of our own perceived power, but in the strength of the one who created us, redeemed us, and sustains us, one in three, almighty and everlasting. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday. We'll see you. Might run into each other virtually or in person sometime this week. Sure to look forward to it, but definitely see you next week for worship as well. Thank you so much. Peace be with you.